Hello, this is Ayatollah Zinaran with PBS Rhodesia. Today we have a very notable broadcast, a special all about the Falklands War. Another notable thing you may have noticed is that we aren't in our regular studio. This is because someone may or may not have burnt down the normal one, Norman.
I did.
You may ask, what brought Argentina and England to military conflict in 1982? Simply put, England occupied the Falklands from 1833 to the time of the conflict. Argentina had continually tried to get the islands back through that time. In 1982, Argentinian forces gave up on trying to get the Falklands for peaceful negotiation, and they launched an invasion. It's believed that the impetus for the invasion was largely political, because the junta, the Argentinian political party at the time, was not popular with the people, and they wanted something that would bring them together. The best way to understand these events is with a visual aid. Here we have our weather correspondent, Cavan Daniels, to help form an idea of the events as before mentioned.
Thank you, Ayatollah. You can tell I'm a different person because of my ridiculous outfit. The invasion of the Falklands happened on the 2nd of April. Coming from the west, the Argentinian forces moved in. On the 14th and 15th of May, there's the raid of Pebble Island, a northern island with four makeshift airstrips. Roughly in this area, the SAS destroyed 11 planes. Daring. The 25th of May had the Battle of San Carlos, which is the first major landing of English troops, which should be roughly there. The Battle of Goose Green was the first major land conflict of the war, which should be about there. On the assault of Mount Kent, that was in late May, there was an SAS on mountain areas surrounding Port Stanley. On the 31st of May, there was the skirmish at Top Mallow House, and on the 10th of June, the skirmish at Many Branch Point in the West Falklands. This was the only land engagement of the entire war in the West Falklands. On the 11th and 12th of June, you had the Battle of Mount Harriet, or the Battle of Two Sisters, or the Battle of Mount Longdon. It's all the same engagement, it just has different names depending on who you ask, because the mountain has different names depending on who you ask. It was a series of offensives outside of Port Stanley, all attempts to get the high ground. The 13th and 14th of June had the Battle of Mount Tumbledown, the highest point outside of Mount Stanley. This was important for observation. And the 13th and 14th of June had the Battle of Wireless Ridge. On the way to the capital of the Falklands, there were seven strategic hills that were important for communications. Port Stanley was taken by the English on the 15th of June, in which the Argentinians surrendered. The 18th of June had the Bluff Cove air attacks. The English forces are bombed by Argentinian forces. You'll notice that was after the war. Thank you, Ayatollah. Back to you.
Thank you. Now that you have a general understanding of the war, let's take a moment to look into the effects of it. Understandably, there was a massive level of frustration and anger within the Argentine people after the conflict. To better illustrate these feelings, we went to Argentina to ask people how they feel about it 10 years past the end of the war. Unfortunately, we couldn't go to Argentina to ask people what they thought due to budgetary restrictions. Instead, we partnered with an Argentinian radio station known as Argentina Radio to get the people's opinion instead.
Hola, esta Radio Argentina. Soy Ricardo Milos, y hoy es muy especial. Nuestros amigos de PBS Rhodesia están aquí para preguntar sobre la Guerra de las Malvinas. No dude en llamar. Está aquí. Hola, ¿cómo está? ¿Qué opinas sobre la Guerra de las Malvinas?
Fue algo bueno, un paso para destruir el colonialismo.
Sí, bien, gracias. Una más. Hola, ¿crees que los británicos estaban justificados en las Malvinas?
¿Qué crees, qué idiota? Oh, si los británicos fueron justos para reivindicar nuestra tierra legítima, punk, por supuesto que no deberían haberlo hecho. Era nuestra tierra legítima. ¿Sabes qué? Ya he tenido suficiente de esto. Ya no voy a responder a esta pregunta. Te odio a ti y a tu estúpida recuerda.
Gracias.
The harsh feelings for the war weren't just on the side of the Argentinians, though. Many people in Europe didn't support the war either. To illustrate this point, we've brought a special guest, Donna Ford, to give his opinion on the matter. He's not English, but you try to find someone who's both European and old enough to remember the Falklands War in Greenville, South Carolina.
Thank you, Ayatollah. With regard to the Falklands War, I think you'll find that the English attitude, as it goes in many ways towards the English, is that, yeah, they were entirely wrong. It's another example of overarching jingoistic colonialism. Now, on the other hand, the junta were no better. They were savage right-wing morons as well. But their idea of taking a tiny rock with the expectation that England wouldn't defend it really wasn't very wise with regard to the English attitude towards their colonialism throughout history. Even though there was 500 miles from the Argentines to the Maldives, as they call it, and a couple or 3,000 miles for the English to go defend them, one English fleet was able to surround the Argentinian army and battered them senseless in approximately 6 weeks. They were better led, better trained, better equipped, and have a history of just being savage about little rocks out in the middle of nowhere. Ireland knows that. Also, secondarily, at that time in history, one of Satan's minions, Margaret Thatcher, was the Prime Minister of the UK, and she wasn't going to let anything go. So, that's about the story of it. Irish never trust the English. This is another example of it.
Thank you, Donna.